Welcome to the Weird Rap Discussion Gang. We are discussing Digable Planets' Blowout Comb from 1994, I think.
Yeah, 94.
Why don't we each go around? Oh, nice, you got the vinyl. Why don't we each introduce ourselves and talk about how we were introduced to Digable Planets in this album? You wanna start, Chief?
Sure, yeah. Chief in the Doomsday Device out of Texas. And I was introduced to this album because I've been a day one Digable Planets fan. Me and my dad used to always kind of share new hip hop with one another if we heard something on Rap City or on TV Raps or whatever. And I remember my dad telling me to keep an ear out for Rebirth of Slick, for Cool Like That, which of course is probably 90% of Digable Planets fans' introduction to Digable Planets. But because I was such a big fan of them, I was really, really on the lookout for what's the next album, what's the next thing, you know. The day that Ninth Wonder hit, I was on it and been a huge fan of this album ever since day one.
Yeah, for me, it was like that Cool Like That song didn't really hit for me. I was kind of ambivalent about it, and then I never ended up even hearing the full album of that of Reachin' until quite a bit later. And I don't know if I even fully listened to it until today. I was just listening to it today. I was like, I gotta actually familiarize myself with their first album a little bit. But for whatever reason, I just didn't have it, didn't listen to it. And then when I was stuck in Malaysia, kind of against my will, when this came out and I couldn't get much rap music, and I saw this in the record store and I was like, I gotta check this out. And I was like, I loved it, but I also wasn't sure if my tape was defective. Cause like in Malaysia, they have these weird like rounded corner cases and the tapes are like gray. And you know, so I was just like, is this even like a legit copy? Because it sounds like the vocals are too quiet and it just sounds weird, but I liked it. And then it wasn't until I read like a review of it that I was like, oh, okay, I guess it must supposed to be sounding like that. But yeah, it's I love it. How about you, Justin?
See, at that time, I was living with a friend who was he's a very musical person, but he's kind of a person who's into Beatles. So it's like, I'm usually the person who's going to be into the bands no one has ever heard of. And he's usually into the good music, you know, knowing kind of what's good and what's not. And he really liked this album. And, you know, I'd listen to it with him. We could kind of share on that because it's kind of an underground, kind of odd album, but at the same time, it's like exceptionally musically developed. And I mean, it wasn't at that time, I was really looking for something to make me think about philosophical ideas. And, you know, I wasn't really hearing that much in Digable Planets, but I mean, just as I listen to it now, you know, it's more of like they're providing kind of an emotion, I feel like, or a temperament. And I kind of relate to that as I, you know, I haven't like really picked up on anything specific lyrically that they're really talking about or pointing to, but there's like their flow seems to me like the primary thing.
Yeah, I totally thought similarly. Like last week I was like to Chief, I was like, it's more about the music for this album. There's not a lot to like pick apart with the lyrics. But then this week I was like going into it and I was like, oh, wow, I think it kind of works with the whole spy theme. Like there's like, they're sneaking in a whole lot of stuff like under the radar. Not only because the vocals are mixed quietly, which is something that a quote from Ishmael Butler that I love. He talked about how he purposefully had the vocals mixed quiet because he referenced George Clinton saying that when you do that, it creates longevity for the album and makes you able to listen to it more without it getting old. And but yeah, the other thing that does is it really obscures a lot of the lyrics. And beyond that, I feel like it's coded, like the lyrics are very much coded with acronyms and numbers and slang to kind of hide what is a, like at first I just thought, yeah, they're talking about Brooklyn a lot, they're talking about being cool and slick, and I just didn't even notice most of the references to like black liberation, revolutionary, like Marxist stuff, Black Panther stuff, a bit of fair amount of Nation of Islam stuff in there. But yeah, I think it's very
well, they're also part of the 5 percenters,
right? Yeah, I think all the time that they're mentioning seven and a crescent, that's a reference to the 5% nation, which I didn't really realize until now. But yeah, I think that's a big part of this album, especially even when you look in the liner notes, it is very much about like freeing political prisoners, and it's apparently patterned after like the Black Panthers newsletter. And then yeah, the more I studied it,
it's like a direct copy of the Black Panther, like down to the color scheme on the front and the fonts and that little symbol in the right corner with the star. That's usually where Huey Newton would be, but on the album cover it's got the Digable Planets.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. But like I said, it's very cryptic for me. And it's funny too, because they're quoted as saying like they purposefully were more literal with this album than the first one, which I guess maybe they were, but still pretty hard to make out a lot of it for me. Especially
I think the big thing I took about from this was, you know, specifically on Black Ego, just the idea that I liked, that I got from it, was that he was talking to that policeman and he was like, yo man, what have I ever had rights? You know, just kind of how he was reacting to this officer. You know, as they say, as opposed to that time, there was a lot of gangster rap. So it would have been people would be like, no, fuck you, copper, fuck you. And it would have been a lot of anger. So they had a totally different way of responding to what they saw and how they would deal with it. And kind of like you're saying, it would be kind of like an underground style, or not underground, but a spy thing, because like you'd be like, a police is going to arrest you and you're going to kind of like do your thing, knowing that what is going on is not okay, but maybe saying that an aggressive attitude is not going to be very useful within that moment. You're going to be more undercover about it.
Yeah, well, like to kind of provide some frame too to both the spy motif as well as their whole, what they were trying to say with the album. To give it a little frame of reference, if you remember on the first album, the way it plays through, it's them explicitly in a jazz club. You know, it starts with like somebody introducing them. You hear audience throughout the album at different parts. And it's got similar little kind of mini instrumental interludes. And then the speaker will come up and kind of say something about the group. So with this album, they didn't really want to be commodified. Like, even though they won a Grammy for Cool Like That for Best Rap Performance, they kind of figured that would give them artistic freedom. But when they came to the label was like, give us another Cool Like That. You know, we want a big hit. And they felt it was really important with this album to make it crystal clear. Like, here's what we intend to do with our music. Here's a little bit about where we come from philosophically, politically. And that's what the whole purpose of Blowout Comb was. So the spy motif kind of frames it like a blaxploitation movie rather than a jazz club performance, which again, you've got those little instrumental stings that or sort of act breaks, you know? And like, here's the cool part of the movie. Here's the dangerous part. Here's the educational part. And I don't know, it's real genius the way they break it up like that.
Yeah, I like the idea of the first album being in a jazz club, and then this album, it sounds more like it's in the streets. Literally, there's parts of it that sound like a block party, and that black block party theme comes in a lot. And of course, it's about the Brooklyn streets. It's like an ode to Brooklyn in a lot of ways. But shall we listen to a little bit of the first track here? As one of my study questions for this was, why is this intro called Slows Comb? That was the intro. I couldn't come up with an answer for that. Anyone? Why it's called Slows?
Yeah. So none of them are actually from New York. Ish is from Seattle. Doodlebug is from Philly. And Mecca is from like the DC area. And they even met in Philadelphia, but they've always claimed New York. And Slows Comb is kind of a play on words for Slocum Place, which is in Flatbush.
Mm. Slocum Place. So is that like where they were living?
Possibly, you know, I mean, I know they were really claiming Flatbush or like some of the different parts of Brooklyn, because like Brooklyn is one of the five boroughs, but then Brooklyn also has its own areas like Bed-Stuy and Flatbush and Williamsburg and just its own little pockets of culture, if you will. So that kind of, I think, was maybe a shout out to Flatbush. And for those in the know, it's set in like, here's the setting of the tale that we're about to tell for you.
That's great. Gold stars for you for that one.
One time for your mind. Two times for Mumia St. Cool. Three times for my Brooklyn dimes. Seven times for pleasure. I don't trip. She don't trip. We don't trip. Nah, we don't trip. He don't trip, G's don't trip, we don't trip, pleasure.
16 times for the mind thieves, for my thinking and dilemma and Erica.
May 4th movement starring Doodlebug, that was another question. Why do they say starring Doodlebug in that track? Because all three of them are on it pretty much equally, I think. Although Doodlebug is in the middle. I like the how it's divided up. I think it's... It goes Ladybug, Ishmael, then Doodlebug has a verse twice as long as the previous two, and then it's Ishmael again on the other side and Ladybug again. This like nice symmetrical little pyramid.
Yeah, I think too, like the reason why it's starring Doodlebug explicitly is because they sort of switch names from the first album to the second album. But the first two are talking about, you know, redefining black people equal to who, and, you know, slap hands from my mans with the lands of crook, just really talking the way that they're going to voice things on Blowout Comb. But then Doodlebug is still kind of talking about galactic travelers and whatnot on the first verse. So I think it's actually reaching Doodlebug rapping on Blowout Comb. Before he gets the knowledge, which is who he was rapping under on Blowout Comb.
Right. Maybe a transitional kind of a thing. That's interesting. And then I didn't know what the May 4th movement was, but that's apparently a reference to a student-led Chinese revolt in 1919, which is pretty obscure. And of course, goes along with the theme of Revolution, which was running all throughout the album.
Yeah, right on. I didn't realize that was that either, because I was researching the May 4th movement, but I guess I was looking in terms of the Black Panthers, and May is an important month in their history, but not May 4th specifically.
Yeah, that phrase specifically, the May 4th movement, is used to denote that that event, which I don't know the real details on beyond that. And here is Black Ego.
You wish to give up the right to remain silent?
Hell yeah.
So now let's let in two. In my pocket pack, pummeling our epic black ethic lack. I walk again, you a shade gray. Come display mazes in black. Fire in the west, shit is shaking, it's fine. I'm in Mickey's Wonder Vision vinyl time. Up the forts where I'm caught in my throat, they're shaking up a few loops. Now I let my cool shoot, K-Risk one. Cause we fade in and out, are you swinging or coming? Now I'm solid on this store. This ain't living, it's heavy, every setback. Even when I was a shorty, now we caught you in your fold. Thrice, check me in another place, space and joy. Nothing you can serve could ever ace me, boy, fat laces.
I want to know if there's like a name, a search term to find symbols that sound like that. Is that a kind of a symbol? If anyone listening knows the answer, tell me, because I want to sample symbols that sound kind of like that. Anyway, you chose this track particularly, right, to talk about, Justin, or not? I forget.
Yeah, this was the one that like stood out most to me. I mean, it was funny too, because I was listening to the album and I heard the song. Okay, I'm like, all right, this will be my song. And when I was researching it, that song kept coming up as a significant song in the album. And I mean, something that just stood out to me was just the dreamlike quality of the beat, which I'm really attracted to, kind of looking for that stuff. And you know, I found people kind of saying that was kind of known for that, and then ending it with a guitar solo on top of a sample based beat, which is, are all of them sample based? Because some of them seem like they're pretty live, or are they all sample based?
They are all a mixture, I believe, of samples and live instruments.
Yeah, from what I understand, Ishmael would sample drums and then reprogram and flip the drums, and then he would have live instrumentation on top of his sample drums.
But I did not get the moral of the story of what this song was about. I mean, I said before, I was like, I like the idea of how they approached in responding to their oppression and their kind of way of handling it versus being just aggressive and giving the police reasons to, you know, do stupid shit. They had a different approach, and I like that, but I did not understand like the meaning of black ego or what that title meant.
Yeah, I didn't dig that far into it to have an answer for that either.
With the album being really about identity and taking the power back in terms of having a voice and not being silenced and oppressed by, or being disenfranchised by, the powers that be, the black ego thing is sort of just giving an okay. It's like, it's all right to be proud of yourself. You know, it's all right to treat yourself as a man or more than a man and navigate the world like anybody else would that doesn't have the same skin that you have or the same black designation as you have. So it's sort of like, not necessarily a rallying cry per se, but it's like an empowerment thing.
So I guess from my perspective as a white kid from the suburbs growing up, to a certain extent, the black culture has always been idolized, and there has always been a definite identity and a pride in that identity. So was that something that was encouraged and brought about? Because as far as I knew, that always existed, or was things like Digable Planets gave people the power to do that and to feel comfortable and free to do that?
So, yeah, as far as cultural pride, that's always been around. You know, like for 2 out of 3 members of the Digable Planets are direct. Well, no, I guess Doodlebug's dad was involved with the Black Panthers, but Butterfly's dad was just politically active in Seattle, but wasn't specifically involved with the Panthers. He just supported the Panthers. And then Ladybug's parents were both political. But it's kind of culture and empowerment, just in the sense of the way that black pain has always been commodified, you know, and it's never really okay to just stand up and say, I'm proud of my blackness, or I'm proud of my skin, or I'm proud of my hair. You know, it's always sort of this weird fascination connected to it, or this weird objectification connected to it, that brings less humanity to the situation than there inherently should be. So that, I think that's kind of my read on the situation based on knowing the history of the group and the whole like interaction with a police officer opening the song and whatnot.
Yeah, like we mentioned the blaxploitation references in this that are throughout this album, in the lyrics especially, and I mean that a lot of the music just sounds like it's from like a blaxploitation movie, but although it's not, I don't think. But anyway, that like was, I think, a kind of a first in like mass culture of inserting like black. It was, again, like in a subversive way, because it was in the guise of action films, but it was inserting a lot of black pride and black revolutionary values into the movies. And yeah, and then as far as the ego thing goes, I noticed in the track Four Corners later in the album, Butterfly is mentioning the id and the super id. Oh, yeah, and he says, I pump a fist, even my hands got an ego, id and super id. The kid is super kid. But doesn't mean a whole lot to me besides just like pride and belief in self, kind of, I don't know.
Well, it's also kind of interesting to me as far as like researching what the five percenters are. And I mean, they're saying that not only should you have pride in your black culture and black history, but that you're actually a race of gods to a certain extent. So it's like, how powerful are they saying the black ego is or should be?
And knowledge of self is a saying. I don't know exactly what it means, but
It is about understanding your power. It's just because of the whole, like, you know, and I guess I'm gonna speak a little freely, so hopefully I don't offend anybody or offend listeners. I don't think y'all will take offense, but there's this whole kind of cultural having to deal with this superiority or god complex. So one of the tenets of the 5% nation from day one was a knowledge of self, being that we're a stolen people that were brought to America and never really given a chance to understand our history or where we're from or have pride in that. So the only thing you really have is a knowledge, wisdom, and understanding of yourself and your system and your situation and how you can manifest into, you know, a greater person, you know. But the whole the black man is God thing is sort of an attempt to rebalance the scales, you know.
Is there a black man is God as a superior, or is there a black man is God as powerful and equal? Like, what is the, you know, what the meaning is behind that?
Black man is God in the sense that all men are supposed to be created in the image of God, but, you know, up until the late 1800s, we were considered less than men, you know, we were considered 3/5 of a man. And then even after given freedom, it wasn't really until the 60s that there was integration and separate but equal and whatnot. So it's all really a matter of God, you know. We're all made in the image of God. So the black man, I don't want to directly equate it to like a Black Lives Matter sort of thing, but it's kind of the same deal. It's, yes, everybody is made in the image of God, but it's important to understand that the black man, you know, black people are made in the image of God too, because we are men, we are human, we should be treated with equal footing, just like anybody else should.
I'm sure there are a bit of variances too in the interpretations of that.
Could be.
As far as like, I don't know. I'm not well versed enough to speak on it, but I mean, in general, it's a reaction to white oppression.
Yeah.
DPS forever hit you with the lobster. Suleiman the Bronx Ripper on the lobster. Lee Love, that's my money like Domino. Brooklyn, no keep it rockin' till the sun shows. I pop my junk, my junk, I pop my junk, my junk. I pop my junk, my junk, pop my junk, my junk. I pop my junk, my junk, like what you want, pop my junk, my junk, I pop my junk. The noise that we made is blue.
That was Doggett. And this is Jettin'.
We jettin' up, we jettin' down, down, down. Cross, cross, town. We jettin' all around. No wonder, no wonder, a fun, a fun, fun song.
I live Brooklyn like year 24 for sure. Soon see no in my tennis skirt. And the kick hurts so good, bet I gotta sort the accents for this. Now here's a notion for my nation, cause I place you on the dynamite, right? The cream.
Just listening to this in headphones today for the first time in a long time, and just right then noticing another example of, yeah, the amazing mixing in this album. Ladybug's voice is panning back and forth right there. And just like all in general, there's a lot of great panning and just beautiful mixing in this album, I would say. And then Ladybug, I gotta just mention, like, she's fucking amazing on this album. Just like lyrically, like the poetry alone, looking at it written, is amazing and confusing in a lot of places. Like, it's kind of cryptic to me, but just beautiful. And also, like, I notice her rhyme schemes are really advanced, especially for the time. Like, there's a lot of places where you think a rhyme is gonna come and it doesn't, and it still, she makes it work perfectly. Yeah, and she's another thing I love about it is she sounds so angelic and almost like a kid. But then her lyrics are so just like, there's like examples of her just talking about like slitting throats and holding the shotgun, and just like, it kind of goes with that theme of like subversively sneaking in the extreme revolutionary stuff.
Yeah, it's always awesome how they've treated her like an equal in the group. You know, it's never like she chose the name Ladybug, you know, but always had the Mecca thing there, but it was never like, and then here's the lady in our group, you know. It's just, here's an equal MC, you know. And I never really realized that they kind of set the framework for what the Fugees picked up and ran with. You know, it's the same lineup, exact same lineup.
Yeah.
Did anyone catch, I guess, the idea of what the revolution looks like and how, you know, it's like, is it going to be a means of people loving each other? Is it going to be a means of there some sort of uprising? Like, when they would talk about revolution, I didn't ever catch a specific one of like what the revolution looks like.
Specifically, they reference Marx and Black Panthers, and I think it's a violent revolution that they're alluding to in a lot of ways, or militant. You know, militant resistance.
Definitely power redistribution.
Okay.
This is Burrow Check.
Who's popping? We don't drop down. When it's the 718, and everything is straight.
We live in Brooklyn.
With the type street curb hangers and the beat don't stop.
We live in Brooklyn, Brooklyn.
It's no lie, do or die, and the land is showing proof.
We live in Brooklyn, Brooklyn, Brooklyn.
What keeps, you know, my fist and butter's fro.
We live in Brooklyn, Brooklyn, Brooklyn.
Fly clothes, cash flow, and Tracy L's the spark.
It's crowded plus they jerking my space, shouted cause they chase. When I strut out, sift through my block, I'm ooh. Shift my mood to break, stole my mind back black. So what you play the board skimmer, we got butter, so surfaces out.
High and Fly, and this is Dial 7. Wanted to talk about this one specifically, right, Chief?
I did, yeah. I think if anybody was looking for like a sort of clear-cut manifest of this is what we're trying to do with this album, and this is the emotional tone we're setting for this album, Dial 7 is a good entry point for that. You know, like the chorus kind of explicitly lays down some ideologies that are talking about, you know, with the devil speaking with forked tongue and black people stealing their mind back and, you know, like turning guns the other way, i.e. just kind of trying to quell black on black crime because we're not going to uprise divided, you know, which is what the system is trying to do with us anyway. And then I heard Doodlebug kind of speak on the whole seven aspect of Dial 7. And it fits into the blaxploitation narrative. And they're just imagining a world where you could hit seven on the phone and get back up wherever you are, you know? And the seventh letter representing G being the God letter, which is 5% nation ideology. So this one is kind of subversively and surface level, really just setting the tone for what Blowout Comb is about.
Yeah, I was thinking a lot about this song too, because like, I think also Dial 7 is the name of like a luxury car service in New York City, like a precursor to Uber, or like a step up above a taxi, something like that. But I don't know, I assume that they were referencing that as well. But then the subtitle on this is it Axioms of Creamy Spies, I think. Yeah. And I was like, so I was trying to like rack my brain about what is this spy thing about? And I think I figured it out, but the creamy part, I was like, well, this creamy is just like smooth and slick goes along with that. But then they say in the lyrics, like the cream always rises, you know, and it's like kind of alluding to an uprising, I think.
The spy thing too also is kind of educational as well. It's sort of with them being Panthers, COINTELPRO, this kind of goes hand in hand with the Panthers. And so they're talking a whole lot about being aware because you are being monitored and et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, spy versus spy type of a thing.
Automatic, systematic.
Automatic.
The feeling's right, the music's tight. The farting out of Crookin' type Saturday night. The gear, the garbage rocking type way out of sight. Limping past the project, see my man, aight. Steelo type fat, solar type facts. Later for milk and honey, get the money out this piece, relax.
Relax.
I handle streets so type slick, just like a 7-0 lap.
She got moist,
cause I got the platinum voice, like syrup, for Del Froman, the New York boroughs as they temp our perms. Plus I ride the iron worms uptown, across down from the boogie with no faking. Ghetto to my marrow, then ease on back to Brooklyn. Hold it, as Luke in my Tim's and army suits, parlaying where Malcolm stood, now brothers push they blow out. A slicker nigga pick dick me picking my fucking fro out. Limping up the 135s, the PJs, to eject these herbs, that's word to green herb. Now the curbs, I play that like Primo Supreme, hustler nappy hair, oil slick, loyal to kicking dirty snare, little panther. Answers to the nom de plume butter, nicer, preciser, rubber, slicer and cutter. In a freshly dipped state, I contemplate whose avenue be making the most bacon. My honey gets the loot out, I was shaking. We get in live, dreaming, being in the central air bus stop. Then
I like how well the J. Rue the Damager is on that cut too. I wasn't sure if that was going to work the first time I saw he was a guest, but it works well.
Yeah, it's cool. I wonder if it was a purposeful thing to kind of incorporate J. Rue, who was like the brand new. He like representing like he. I don't think his album he'd even come out yet, and then they include Guru from like, you know, who represents more like the established late 80s, early 90s hip hop. They have Jazzy Joyce, who is more from like the mid 80s. And they're, of course, sampling and referencing all of these previous like jazz and soul artists, like kind of like referencing this legacy of great black music.
I don't know for sure if Jazzy Joyce is from Brooklyn, but I know J. Rue is from Brooklyn.
Yeah.
And also part of Guru's crew as well. So
yeah, Guru, they're from Brooklyn too, right?
I feel like I know DJ Premier isn't, but Guru might be.
One of the things when researching this was everyone was talking about how unappreciated it was. And what on a Grammy, I'm just wondering why everyone was kept mentioning how undervalued and underappreciated it was.
The first album won a Grammy. Cool. Like that. I mean, this album actually kind of broke up the band just because it didn't sell well.
Yeah, I believe it got like pretty decent reviews critically, but the audiences were not ready for it. It was kind of a flop. Sales
they set a bar. They also set a really high bar with Cool Like That. Like Cool Like That was such a huge single that they went gold with that album off that single alone, and that's just a really, really high bar to reach again when you put out a follow-up album. That whole sophomore jinx thing.
And it sounded like they were kind of upset and felt objectified with Cool Like That kind of being too generic. And so they wanted to switch that up as well. So, I mean, were they comfortable with it not as doing as well commercially then?
I think I recall reading that they were a bit upset with how the album wasn't promoted properly. I think they wanted it to do better than it did, but they were also consciously going less commercial with the sound, so maybe in retrospect, you know, what could they expect? But
their label relatively new too, like Pendulum Records hadn't been around that long, and Digable Planets was one of their flagship artists. So with the second album, they were really hoping for another hit, and the label people didn't hear a hit on the album. So like Jonah said, they didn't promote it because they didn't hear a song for them to promote.
Okay. I wonder what it'd be like to go to a concert of this. Like, would it just be like people, I can just imagine like having fun smoking some weed and just chilling out. That would be my imagination of it.
Yeah, I saw they were on some talk show, some late night show, performing music from this album. With a full band.
They were on Soul Train.
I didn't see that one.
They might have been on our show. I don't remember if he was still around too, but I know they did Soul Train.
It was some white dude, I think, his show. John Stewart, maybe, or no, that was before John Stewart. I don't know. And I recently heard a live recording. They released a live album that's very nicely recorded, but from their reunion tour that happened more recently. It's a little, for me, it's like the live band takes something away from the recorded version, which had more elements of samples, which I like, you know, I like that, the balance they had, which was perfect, I think.
I saw them in like 2005 or 2006 when they did the first reunion, and they were just touring with a DJ, and their energy was amazing together, which I had heard rumors that they weren't really all that on the same page up to that point. And I had already seen C Knowledge with the Cosmic Funk Orchestra solo. So I had transitioned him sort of out of the Digable Planets framework. But when I saw them, they were on it. Like, they were killing it. It was one of the best hip-hop performances I remember seeing. And maybe it's just my nostalgic connection to the music. Like, I really love Digable Planets a lot, but they held up. They met all my expectations.
Yeah, whatever happened, they were not public about the whole story with why they really broke up. But also, Ladybug's, both of her parents died apparently right as this album was coming out, and that may have messed things up to some degree. But I wanted to talk about the album title too, like. Do you guys have any thoughts about why they named this the Blowout Comb?
My thought was, you're saying like the comb isn't natural, but it wasn't the comb, it was the afro they were referring to, right?
Yes.
And that being natural and taking pride in how your hair grows naturally, as opposed to maybe what society was expecting at that time.
Yeah, that's very on the nose with it, with the afro being sort of a pride symbol and the blowout comb being part of the blowout kit to really get your afro like Angela Davis style.
Yeah, what I was saying was like that quote that I read, that it was about the utilization of the natural, didn't quite sit with me, because you're not utilizing a afro with a pick, you're more, what I thought was, you're amplifying the volume of your afro. Yeah, basically like increasing the volume or amplifying it, which I feel like that's what this album is doing. It's amplifying these messages of Afrocentricity. And then I also heard the theory about like that you make a fist when you're using the afro pick, which I also thought wasn't quite right, because I feel like it's more like a something like that. But then on the other hand, like that kind of goes with the whole subversive angle of it, because like you're kind of making a fist and you're kind of raising it up in the air when you're doing that. So in like the kind of sneaky spy way of like, it kind of works whether they meant that or not.
Can I show you something real quick?
Yeah.
Like, here's a pick. This is like my dad's old pick right here. And they used to have the fist on it.
Oh, that's what, that makes sense. That was just the normal part of the pick back then?
Some ones, like this one's a really high quality one. It's one he's had since the 60s. But yeah, they used to like a fist symbol would be a really good, important part of your pick, you know, back in the day.
I think what you're saying, John, is like, it's kind of odd to say utilizing the natural as opposed to when it sounds like you're amplifying and showing the greatness of something as opposed to accepting what is natural. There seems to be more of an amplification.
Yeah, to me that just seemed like a stretch, because they're saying a comb is a utility and you're using it on your afro, and it's just like, it just didn't seem right to me, but maybe, who knows.
Yeah, well, it's kind of too what the afro stands for. Like, inward, it's a pride thing, and then outward, it's an intimidation thing. You know, like,
yeah,
my will be heard this way, not in some muted way, which kind of goes to the amplification.
Yeah, I definitely agree that it has to represent the natural Black Afrocentric thing, but also the pride, you know, because it's big and visible, and it's like, yeah, I'm obviously proud of my Blackness.
It's just funny how intimidating hair can be sometimes, you know. You got an afro and people are either fascinated by it or in fear.